I can introduce myself. My name is Tim Kautz, and I'm currently a researcher at Mathematica Policy Research. And today, I'm going to be presenting some early results from an ongoing study in Shanghai. And I'm working with several collaborators, including Yuanwan Chin, Shuaseng Feng, and Jim Heckman on this work. And we're presenting this work now. It's a part of a three-year study, in part. And so we're at year two, so we're going to show some early findings. But I want to present it now because we have an opportunity to collect more data and possibly conduct another experiment. And we are very open to suggestions or ideas of what could be interesting, things that could address questions from this presentation or other things that came out of this conference. So we'd love to hear about that. I'm going to skip most of this because I think it's already been covered multiple times. But I do think that there's this real sense out there, and which Richard brought up, which is how do we measure these types of skills in a practical setting in schools? And one option and one candidate is self-reports. And a commonly used self-report, as you heard a lot about today, is the Big Five. So that's sort of the preface that I want to give you and information you need. So, before I tell you what we did, I want to show you our impact results, and I want you to think of these results. These are the main results from our study. And I want you to imagine right now that you're seeing the results of evaluation of a social program, and that this social program had a control group, it had a treatment one and a treatment two, and then we're looking at how these two treatments affected a math score that was given to fourth, or math test that was given to fourth graders, and how they also affected the Big Five traits, or measures of the Big Five traits. And what you'll notice is that treatment one, whatever that was, had relatively little impact on the math score. And let me, I should explain what this figure means. So these bars represent standard deviation units of an impact. The whiskers affixed to them are plus or minus one standard error on that impact estimate. And the dots affixed to the top indicate tests from statistical significance. So the red one is at the 5% level, and the diamonds at the 10% level. So what is this showing? Well, it's showing whatever this treatment one was didn't really affect math scores. But it did seem to have a big effect on virtually all of the Big Five. And it was positive in the sense that if we think about these as being sort of normed in a way that tend to correlate with positive outcomes, they were positively affected. And so in our data, we can also verify that by looking at how they're correlated with grades and things like that. So they're all in a sort of positive direction. And then whatever treatment two was really didn't have any significant impact on the Big Five, but there's a hint that it had an impact on the math score. So let me tell you a little more about what these treatments were. Both treatments cost about a dollar or less per student, and both of them took less than 5 minutes to deliver to a classroom, and that was the entire intervention. And I didn't actually calculate what a rate of return for this would be if we thought of it as a social program, but I think it would likely be very large. It costs about a dollar, maybe if you factor in the classroom time, $10 at most. Yet, they seem to be producing dramatic effects on the Big Five, and to some extent, an effect on the math score. You might say, oh, if you were just viewing it based on this evidence alone, if we combine these two treatments, maybe we would solve a lot of problems. It would improve math scores, we would improve these personality traits, capture a lot of domains. And if you're thinking that sounds a little too good to be true, then I think you're on the right track. Sounds a little bit like those internet ads that say, like, one weird trick to success. So I think that's the right idea. So let me tell you now what the intervention actually was. And so to give you some background in the study, in 2015, we had a group of fourth graders, and we gave them a math test. We also asked some other survey questions. And then in 2016, we conducted an experiment in the spring of 2016 where we assigned different treatment conditions immediately before they took the test. So right before they took the test, treatment one, they were told, if you score in the top 10% overall on this test within your school, or you improve in the top 10% relative to how you did on the fall 2015 test, you would get a certificate of honor recognizing your achievement. Treatment two received a financial incentive, and they were given the same thing, except instead of a certificate of honor, they would get 50 yuan, which is about $7.50. And these are fourth graders, so that's a decent amount of money. And then immediately after the test, while they were in classrooms of people in the same treatment, we administered the Big Five, a self-report version of the Big Five based on the Big Five inventory, 44-item version of it. And the idea was, the basic idea was we wanted to sort of map out that figure that we put up before. The question was, we wondered whether actually maybe giving these incentives somehow changed the way that people would respond on these questionnaires. It somehow shifted their mind, their mind frame. And so now I've just added the labels so you can see which incentive had an effect on which. And what you see is that the financial incentives seem to have some effect, although not huge, on their test score, this math test score. Yeah.
So I have a quick question about the first treatment. Because the first treatment is very typical in any like Chinese school and whatever. So when you do the control and not control group, and are you sure, because the students are getting used to this type of treatment. So maybe not about math, but the teacher will use that one for other subjects. So maybe that's the reason you are getting harder to pick up the treatment effect through the first treatment.
Yeah, I think that's possible. I think there's a sense in which we were also wondering about that these are students who are often in a situation where they're publicly recognized for their success.
In my experience, your assignment do well, and the teacher will have the dialogue, and then if this week you did well, and then they will give you, for example, some red flower or something like that.
Yeah.
And then the student will get used to this kind of treatment and over again.
And I think that is a real possibility. And it was interesting, another kind of cultural thing I learned about is these, at least in some areas in China, there's these red kerchiefs that students wear. And only some students wore. So I asked why are some students wearing these and others not. And it turns out that, it's in honor.
A different age. But after some age,
everyone has it. But in primary school, basically, you earn the right to wear this kerchief based on your performance in school and how the teacher rates you. And it's this very public display of, these students are the good students. So I do think there's the cultural differences here. But that aside, the financial incentive nevertheless seemed to have some effect. And so basically, now let me tell you the motivation for this study. We decided we wanted to take this diagram that we kept putting up at conference after conference seriously, and to understand how performance on this test score and self-report could be, in particular, influenced by some kind of aspect of the situation. Yes?
You can feel free to answer this later if this is too big picture, but it seems a lot like what may be going on is that it's a sort of a framing or a prime. You're priming someone to think of honor versus priming them to think about money or something like that. This looks a lot like a priming intervention to me. And do you know whether it's that or if this is really an incentive story?
Well, yeah, so we don't know. And I'm very interested to hear interpretations on this, partly because we spent a long time looking for experiments that do exactly this, but couldn't find any. So that's my take on this evidence, is basically somehow it changed the way that they viewed reporting on this questionnaire. And I don't think they viewed it, the incentive wasn't tied to their performance on the Big Five in any way. It somehow changed the way that they sort of viewed themselves. But it wasn't like they were getting a certificate for their performance on that. So in fact, I think it must be that story. I don't think there's too much else. And so the other thing that this figure actually simplifies a little bit is this, this is already a daunting challenge enough to try to take apart the skills and the incentives. But the other possibility is that actually the incentives somehow moderate the effect of, the skills moderate the effect of the incentives. And so that's another simplification that we make, but this is something we study here. And there's several examples of studies in the literature that have looked at this kind of phenomenon in cognitive testing. There's a whole series of studies, even starting in the 70s, where they looked at the effect of giving children M&Ms for correct questions on IQ tests, and they found large effects. And then two other studies, including one conducted by my discussant, showed that if you incentivize people on IQ tests or other kinds of cognitive tests, it can at least affect the effort that they put into it. This study didn't find that it affected their overall IQ score, but it did affect the amount of time that people spent answering questions. In both of these studies, they measured the Big Five and saw whether those effects were moderated by the Big Five. And so they found generally that people who were lower in conscientiousness responded more to the incentives. And I think their interpretation is something like, these are people who were not intrinsically motivated, but as soon as you gave them an incentive, they would work harder. But we weren't able to find any experimental studies of really looking at the effect of situation on measurement for non-cognitive skills. And if someone, I'm looking at you, ETS, if you know of something like that, we'd love to incorporate it. So we had four main research questions, which I've touched on a little bit. So to what extent do, in this case, it's really an achievement test, performance and achievement test, depend on incentives? And and I think one thing to highlight for this study compared to other ones is that, at least compared to the two that were looking at effort, we were really looking at the outcome on the test. And we don't have a direct measure of their effort. We just want to understand whether it affected overall performance. And compared to the first ones, the IQ studies were typically done on children with severe learning problems. And so there's this question of how it would differ in a sort of more representative population. And then the second question is, do different types of students respond differently to these kinds of incentives? And how do different incentives work? I think right now a lot of tests that are used in the accountability are really low stakes for students, but really high stakes for schools, in the sense that maybe the students don't really care about their outcome, but their performance could affect whether the school gets closed or gets funding and things like that. And so the question is, maybe it would be good to incentivize these kinds of tests, but it would be weird. It seems strange to incentivize them with money. So we thought we'd look at another possible incentive. and then the fourth was this question of whether the self-report on these non-cognitive measures could sort of be inadvertently affected by the incentives. And we did consider just paying students more if they reported a higher level of these skills, but we thought that actually wouldn't probably, for a lot of contexts, be somehow as interesting. Like, I think it's pretty well known that when people are applying for jobs, they tend to fake. This was really a little bit more subtle, and we wanted to kind of tie it back to the evaluation literature, which is, even if you're not trying actively to change the way people report, could something you do inadvertently do that? And so what we found is that overall the incentives didn't have a large effect on the, oh, go ahead.
Yeah, so right now you had in your two treatments, money versus social comparison, basically. Do you have something that's individual but that's not money, like some kind of gift that they get but don't need to make public? Just to see whether there's something special about money or something special about social comparison.
Yeah, I think, and as we're thinking about how to continue this line of work, I think we're very seriously considering other kinds of incentives that might be more in that category, something material that isn't money, and see whether that has a difference.
Tim, quick clarification. Did the test carry any stakes for the students? Like, was it even just part of their grade, or was it purely a research exercise?
Great question. It was just purely a research exercise, and that's what they were told. It was truly low stakes for them. That's right. And so we found some evidence that the financial incentives had some effect on the overall population. But when we looked at some subpopulations, we found that the better students tended to respond the most to the financial incentives. So there did seem to be some heterogeneity. Although one caveat is that we didn't find that for the big, so we have teacher measures of the big five. We didn't find that for how the teachers rated the students on the big five, but on other ratings of their classroom performance.
So did you say that the top 10% get some kind of prize? Because then if you're not one of the better students, you probably figure there's no point, you're not going to be there.
Yeah, so the reason we were worried about that, so that's the reason why we made the incentive either for improvement, whether you improved the most since the previous test, or whether you were in the top. So that was our goal. We can't really know whether that actually motivated them. And okay. And then we did find that this honor treatment did have a big effect on the self-reported Big Five measures. And what was interesting is, so I didn't explain this part yet, but after students completed their self-report in a classroom with peers of the same treatment group, they returned to their normal classroom, at which point they rated their peers. And what we found is that students in the honor incentive rated, at least females rated their peers more favorably, as well as themselves, whereas males didn't. And so this point already came up a little bit. I think the big question to me is, why did this honor incentive have an effect on the Big Five, even though the incentive wasn't tied directly to the Big Five performance? And I think it's something that already came up a little bit, which is somehow shifted the way students thought about the activity. And maybe they sort of planted the seed of public recognition or this idea of honor, and they wanted to either feel more honorable or something like that. But if anyone has any other ideas about this, I would really love to hear it. Because, it's sort of easy to come up with these theories afterwards, but go ahead.
So what is exactly the first treatment? So if the student get improved or like their top 10, and then you just tell the student to like give the honor to the particular student, and the other student don't know that information, or like you go public, or like
Yeah, so the certificates then were given out in the classrooms. It wasn't like a big ceremony, but they were distributed. Okay, so I think, to me, I think the interesting way to think about these kinds of results is in terms of the evaluation literature, and just thinking about effects on how to interpret the effects of programs on self-reported measures like this. And I think Richard alluded to this study earlier, but there is a meta-analysis that found for six different domains, they sort of aggregated effect sizes for these social-emotional learning programs. They found that five of the six domains, the effect size was around 0.22 to 0.27, and for the last one, it was 0.57. And we were, depending on exactly the specification, we were finding that the honor incentive had an effect of about 0.1 to 0.2 standard deviations. And so it wasn't as big as these kinds of interventions that were designed to build those skills, but it did make me question, how do we think about programs where these are the main, these kinds of self-reports are the main outcomes?
Try another treatment, so not just announce that one, because usually like the teachers will have some kind of summary like every week, and they may like say, oh, some student did well, so maybe student just got used to that one. Maybe you can try like put some announcement and put that one on the wall, like for example for 1 month, and so if the student like perform good and their name are there, and then maybe it will have like a big like incentive compared with just one time announcement, like I guess it will be different. Because the student may care, like, okay, my name is on the wall, and it will be really different.
Tim, I was thinking an even a better thing might be to actually do micro-credentials. You know, they become very, very big. Kids love it. So you get a little badge that you can put on. Seriously, I'm on your Facebook.
Micro-credentials. I never heard of this.
It's a big part of the credentialing world, and it'd be a really cool thing to do.
And
kids love it.
Oh,
it's like a merit badge for a school.
Yeah, like a merit badge. You pop it on your Facebook page, and you can even make it verifiable.
Great.
A scarf in another color?
Yeah, a scarf in another color, and add another scarf, maybe some sort of pin you can put on your scarf. No, I think these are the kinds of ideas we wanted to hear about. So
it could fade with time, and then you'd have to keep reapplying yourself.
Sorry, say that again?
That micro badge could fade with time.
Oh, I see.
And so you'd have to keep working at it. You can't just
like
rest
that idea.
On your laurels.
Yeah.
Tim, to the extent that, I mean, to basically it seems like you're arguing this it's producing social desirability bias, right? So do you have any evidence on whether that persists? I mean, I'm wondering if you looked at the outcomes even a day later, if that would have gone away, in which case we might not worry about it so much.
Yeah, that's a great question. We don't know. I mean, we are surveying, I mean, this is much later, we are surveying the students a year later. A year from the time, and in fact, we are still in the process of designing the survey, so we can add new things. But we could certainly. I think we're planning to assess the Big Five again, so we could check. Yes.
So another came up earlier about how the top students actually did best, and you tried to do the improvement as a metric to get the other students, the low students, to move up. But the low students might not care about improving. That's why they're the low students. And so I wonder, rather than just trying to find other ways, maybe finding an incentive to specifically target that lower group, it might be different from what you have. And I guess improvement itself might not be the right metric. I don't know, but there might be a different incentive to get at different stratifications of your group. And so you might need to have more than what you have here. Or the conditions for getting them might be different. So different color badges, or a different color.
Our thought was and I'd love to hear other ideas, but our thought was $7.50 to a fourth grader, at least for me as a fourth grader, that would have been a huge amount. And even if I was a low performing student, I think that would have probably motivated me to try harder. We're not exactly sure how to interpret that, but part of it is, I think what's happening in some of these other studies where there's IQ, the outcome is IQ or time spent on IQ questions, and they found that the financial incentive didn't affect the overall IQ, but it did affect the effort, the time that people put into it. So I think one other way to do it would benefit a lot from some measure of effort that students put in. I see a lot of questions, and I think I'm at slide 13 out of 67. So I'm going to forge ahead a little bit, hoping that some of them will be addressed as I go. If not, let's talk after. So let me tell you more about the experimental design. So we had this survey of the same math test in the fall of 2015. We ranked within the school students on that math test. And we created triplets of students who were ranked similarly on that test, and then randomized those students into one of the three groups. And the idea is we wanted to balance out as best as possible their pre-math score. So it was a block design. And then the other thing that we really wanted was we had this problem where we were worried about the power for this study, and if we had assigned at the class, we kind of initially thought we'd assign at the classroom level within schools, but when you do that, clustering is a much bigger problem. So we wanted to find some way to do individual level assignment. So what we did is, on the day of the test, we separated students into physically different classrooms based on their individual level treatment assignment. So that was how we tackled that problem. And then students were told about the experimental condition, and then they completed the math test and immediately after the self-report of the Big Five on themselves, at which point then they returned to their original classroom where they assessed a peer who is not necessarily in the same treatment condition. And in fact, at that point, students weren't really aware that there even was an experiment. They didn't know that different students had different conditions. And then 2 weeks later, teachers assessed their own students' Big Five, and we find that the experiment didn't have an effect on this assessment, and so we're kind of using it as a baseline variable throughout our analysis. And what I think happened is that, well, partly the passage of time, but also teachers didn't really know about the treatment status of all their students in their own classroom, just the ones where if they happened to administer the test to them. So the sample consists of approximately 1,900 fourth graders in 19 different schools in Shanghai. And as I said before, we've already done the first two waves, but we have a third wave in 2017, so we'll have the opportunity to do more. The data is very rich. In addition to data we collected from the students directly in 2015, we also had the parents fill out information about their own background. So we have this whole host of demographic variables, partly coming from the parents, partly from the students. In addition, in 2015, we gave a Ravens IQ test with the same math test as I mentioned. And we also have their grades in three different subjects. And I'm told that these grades are largely based on test scores within those subjects, which may be a little different than here. And then in terms of non-cognitive skills, we have the big five, self, peer, and teacher reports. And we didn't collect that data in 2015. And then we also have teacher ratings of the performance of their students on punctuality, discipline, and just their sort of summary measure of their daily performance. So the first thing we did is we looked to see whether we had established baseline equivalency between these 30 different baseline measures and across the three treatment groups. And I didn't want to put a table with so many tests, but this should say 5% level, by the way. But only four of the, so we basically conducted pairwise tests between each group for each baseline variable. And only four of the tests were statistically significant at the 5% level, which is what you would expect. And I created this graph, which just summarizes those p-values versus the uniform distribution. So under the null hypothesis, where there's no differences in baseline between these three groups, you'd expect those p-values to be uniformly distributed. And that's what we find here. So the extent to which they follow the red line, they're uniformly distributed. In particular, down here, they do. So we used a regression model with treatment indicators for the honor and financial incentives, and then a host of background variables, and including school fixed effects. And the main reason for adding these, this is something we decided before running anything, was to just increase the precision of our estimates. And it's especially important for background variables where we have baseline measures of the outcome. So including the 2015 math score really helped reduce the standard errors. So basically, we just included all the variables that we could there. but I also want to mention that the results are actually pretty similar across different specifications, including no covariates. We still find positive effects on the big five. And just to describe the outcomes a little bit, so for the big five traits, we used a factor model that we estimated separately for each of the big five traits. We didn't try to do something exploratory. We wanted them to kind of be in line with how people do it. But we also aggregate them using just adding them up across items or calculating simple means, and we find pretty similar results. And all the outcomes are standardized so that they are mean zero and have a standard deviation of one. So these are the main results, which I've already presented, so I won't go into that. The other thing we did is we estimated impacts on each of the big five items individually, just to see what that distribution looked like, and also to just sort of make sure there wasn't just some item within them that was driving these positive results where in some unexpected way. And what we found, so this is a graph of those 45 impacts for the financial incentive in green, like money, and then the honor incentive in blue. What we found is that the the impacts for the financial incentive were basically distributed around zero. 54% of them were positive and 46 were negative. For the honor incentive, 88% were positive, and they were distributed around something above zero. And so that convinced us that there was some sort of consistent pattern there. And this is a similar graph to the one I showed you of the p-values from these running the individual items separately. And you can see that for the financial incentive, they basically follow the uniform distribution. And if I did a test to see if there was any difference, and there wasn't for the honor incentive, or for the financial incentive. But for the honor incentive, you can see that there's a disproportionate number of low p-values. And when you test for whether they're distributed normally, you reject it strongly. So we also looked at the effects separately by gender. And the main difference was that the incentives seemed to be more effective for females than men, at least in terms of the test score. We're not quite sure how to interpret this. So this is the effects for males. And you can see for the big five, it's sort of the same pattern for the honor incentive, but virtually no effect on math score for males. Whereas females, not all the big five were statistically significant, but they all showed a similar pattern. And we wouldn't reject that they were different from the estimates of males. But you'll see that actually for females, both incentives there's some hint that both incentives were effective at raising their math score, although it's only significant at the 10% level. So I think that was one of the other questions that we have, is why are the females doing better or responding more?
We didn't have the hypothesis.
We didn't have that. We didn't have that initially. It's something we discovered.
So Tim, when you first designed this experiment, what was the question that you were trying to ask? Which was better, honor or incentives, financial incentives? Is that the question you were asking?
Yeah, so it's sort of that whole host of questions at the beginning, but we wanted to, I think there was this, part of the motivation for including both was there is this literature showing that financial incentives can move test scores, and we need to see if there's some other kind of incentive that could. And then partly because we show that figure with the different boxes and arrows at every conference, we said, oh, we should actually look at to see what the spillover effect might be on Big Five.
I will say, I saw a recent article on the effects of skiing, specifically for gender differences, and that teachers often characterize males as having the innate ability in math and females as not bringing up enough effort.
Oh,
so you're seeing the difference here could be because the incentive is that effort, and so that could be part of the work.
Yeah, that's a good, so that was something I wondered about too, a little bit, and then we looked at their math grades and all these other dimensions, and it turned out the female students were doing much better already, and it might be because those are sort of more incentivized already because they're contributing to their schooling.
But the values are actually the same, it's just what gets incentivized and the feedback that comes back to them is more about innate ability versus effort. Mm. And so it's not that their performance is actually different, it's that how things are being told to them when they're getting feedback on their performance. Mm. Is that teachers often characterize males as, you know, you're doing great, you have a great ability in math, whereas, oh, you're doing great, you really worked hard on this.
Oh,
I see. Interesting.
Yeah, girls
are
found to have lower self-efficacy in math, despite that they perform the same. They evaluate themselves as lower.
They undervalue their skills.
But this would suggest they also have more of a growth mindset.
Yeah, that's what is weird to me, that then they put the effort with the incentive. Because I would think that the self-efficacy would make you not to try because you are told, like, you believe you are not good at this. So that.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
it's also hard to compare the under incentives for men and women because you don't know if one group gets more than the other, but how they're perceived by one. So the financial incentives I can see being very similar, but the honors incentive could be very different.
Yeah, that's a good point. So we analyzed the peer rating data in two ways. There's two ways to kind of arrange the data. One is arranging students by their treatment status and then looking at how those students were assessed by their peers. The other way is to arrange the data by treatment status and look how the incentives affected how students assess each other. So we did both. And this is the way that students in different treatment groups were assessed on these dimensions by their peers. And there was very little evidence that they were assessed differently. And in some ways, to me, this was like a placebo test, which is, it would be really surprising if they were assessed differently based on their treatment status, given that it was unknown to the peers who were assessing them. And even if their peers, there was some effect on how peers assess people, who assessed them, which treatment group they were in, was random. So we we didn't expect there to be a result there, and there wasn't, which was somehow comforting, actually. But when we looked at how the effect of the incentives on how people doing the assessing, we found some hints that they were assessing their peers more positively, kind of consistent with our previous findings. And when we separated that by gender, we found that males didn't assess their peers more favorably, but females did in a kind of striking way. And I don't know how to, again, this is something I don't quite know how to interpret. My best explanation is somehow they're less self-centered or they're more altruistic. But maybe, yeah.
That same thing also showed that they got more interested in these when things became communal. So those incentives may have been more about the communal social aspect of it, and that was a big part of the engagement and STEM.
Oh, interesting. And that was different by gender. Oh, interesting.
So, Tim, you have that data because you have agreeableness in your measure, so you could actually kind of test that, right?
That's a good point.
Yeah, you kind of block on that variable, and you should be able to build.
That's a good suggestion. We haven't done subgroup analyses for these outcomes yet. So that's a really good suggestion. good segue. Subgroup analyses. So we focused on the math test primarily for the subgroup analyses. And I know I'm running low out of time, so I'm going to summarize this. We did look at the subgroup analyses by their self-report of the Big Five, and the patterns weren't particularly consistent, although it might be worth a closer look. And the main thing that we found was that, so these are, this graph is showing teacher assessments of these three categories, punctuality, performance, and discipline, and also whether the student was a so-called group leader in their class. And that's a position that they could be, I think it differed by school, but it was something that either the teacher or students sort of appointed them to be. And what we found consistently is that the ones in the higher, more disciplined, more punctual classes tend to respond more to both incentives for the math test. And similarly, so this is not similarly, actually. We looked at whether there were differences in responses by IQ, the earlier version of the math test, and their math grade, and didn't find any big differences between subgroups in that way. And similarly, we looked at the Big Five, given the other literature that showed that there were differences in responses to incentives by those, and we didn't find any consistent patterns. There are some hints, but nothing that kind of blew us away. So I think I'm basically out of time, which is convenient. So I think the idea behind this was to really think about how, and I know this has come up multiple times today, but how these kinds of self-reports could be problematic in something like an impact evaluation. And what we found is that they could be possibly sensitive to something like framing or some kind of incentive. And so I think it does, I think it really does call for some kinds of measures that could be less sensitive to that, especially if we think that interventions might have some kind of similar psychological effect on how people respond, apart from their effect on the skills. And so I guess that is to say, I think for our next study, what I would really love to do is do something constructive where we think of a measure that we think would be less susceptible to some kind of bias and see whether it is relative to the self-report. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Okay. So let me start by saying that I think this is a really great project, and I find the results mostly very intriguing. I think they also find the results a little bit intriguing. Basically, they want to figure out how incentives, I think, affect measures of skills, or how incentives affect effort that could affect measures of skills. So they're running an experiment, and the idea is very simple. You provide incentives that should change effort and see if and how these incentives change the relevant measures. So what are the measures that they're looking at? They're looking at two types of measure. One is a cognitive measure, which is performance on math test. And the other one is a non-cognitive measure, which is basically the answers to one of the big five questionnaires. So I think it's fairly clear that we would expect that test scores would be higher with the provision of incentives. So, you know, it's sort of like the same way as rats running in a in the mazes when they're hungry and then they... So ex ante, you know, at least our undergraduate students tend to behave like that, not to say that they're rats or anything. What we should expect in terms of the non-cognitive measures is not completely clear, but thinking that they might be affected is in an experiment is not completely crazy. So when you run experiments and you want, you know, you sort of like tend to put in the end all the things that you don't really care about or care about less because you are saying, well, this is not the main thing and maybe it would affect how people behave in any other measures. But we don't know how they are going to be affected, and that's what they are trying to look at. So what is the setup? So we are looking at Chinese fourth graders that take a survey at school, and as part of the survey, they are doing this test and answering these questionnaires. So I think this was mentioned before. I mean, we might expect that the baseline motivation of this group would be fairly high, because these kids might be intrinsically motivated by their culture that puts a lot of effort on like doing well on these type of things. They might also be sort of like in an environment that extrinsically motivate them by their teachers. They are very young, so we might expect that, you know, if the teacher tells you, okay, now it's the time to put effort, this is really important, try your best, they, you know, fourth graders might, are more likely to put effort than 12th graders, maybe. So that could hurt in terms of finding any effect. The randomization here is done at the individual level, not the school or not the classroom, but that meant, I think that they forced you, right? This was not your own decision. That exposed, yeah, they don't like it, right? So exposed, that meant that all the students were eligible for all the rewards if they met the requirements. And so the good thing about this is we know that everything is balanced because it's actually randomized at the individual level. You know, you might have problems with any kind of follow-up because they are going to expect now rewards because everybody got rewards, even those who were not told about the rewards. So they might, you know, if you're thinking about experiments for the next round, I would have imagined that they're expecting something. So we have two types of incentive, and I think the ones that sort of like you mainly your first interest, that would be my guess, is these honor incentives. Now, when you give honors incentives, it must be a tournament. You cannot give honor incentives in a piece rate form. And therefore, if we want another treatment which is comparable, what we need to do is to have a tournament also for the monetary incentives, right? Because otherwise it would be completely different ways of giving incentives, so you cannot compare between these two.
Why can you not do it piece rate?
Well, you can do, but then the comparison is comparing apples and bananas, right? Because it's not the same. So if you give honors incentive, must be a tournament, must be the top. So if you want to say, well, does honor... You can say I give all types of incentives, but if you want to keep like the same, I think that this was what they were thinking about, right? You want to say, well, does honor incentives behave very differently than monetary incentives? Having a piece rate, I mean, you can do whatever you want, but having a piece rate incentive and then comparing them to honors incentives and not finding that they're the same, then I would stand here and say, well, of course they're not the same. I mean, this is a tournament and this is a piece rate.
A relative distinction necessarily? I mean, right. You could just present it as an honor.
No, you could, but I think that was the idea behind having this the exact same structure. I mean, that would be my guess.
Piece rate and monetary.
Oh, you could have done. No. It could, but again, if you want to say something about honor, so you want to keep as much. I think that was maybe not. That was my guess about why they did it like this. Might be wrong. That means that so these tournaments are not necessarily providing the same incentives to everyone, right? I mean, so in order to put effort in a tournament, you must think that you have a chance to win. Because if you're sure that you have no chance to win, these tournaments do not provide any incentives. Obviously, you have an experiment, you want to have a control group, and obviously they have one. So here's the figure. Now, after I heard your presentation, now I know why there were two, and this I took the one with the treatment one and treatment two. So the blue one is the honor incentives, and the purple one. Is the monetary incentive. So let's talk a little bit about the outcome, about the cognitive outcome. So the incentives had a small impact on the math test scores overall. They raised performance of the girls and of the students that are better behaved, and to a lesser degree also those who are better performing students, which are maybe also the girls. At least the better behaved are certainly the girls, and also most of the time the better performing are the girls. So it could be that the incentive structure actually affected only the top students. I bugged him quite a bit to prepare all sorts of graphs for me. Thank you, Tim, I'm sorry about that. We don't really have a paper and it's initial, so I felt, oh, that's great. Now I can ask him all sorts of questions. Why don't you run some regressions for me? Sorry about that. As I said, I really found it intriguing. So
I'm running regressions.
So, well, I can tell you he didn't sleep that much. By the time that I got emails from him, he was not sleeping that much last week. So it seems that the improvement in reaction to the incentives is actually concentrated at the top, right? I mean, so even those who improved seems to be the better students. So one thing that could happen here is that they just don't find this big effect because this is really like it's only the top that are changing the effort level for whatever reason, and these are the only guys that are affected. So basically looking at everybody and saying, well, the incentives don't affect everyone, yes, it's true, but maybe we should not have expected them to affect anyone. We also think that it's possible that the control group was fairly, it's possible that they started relatively highly incentivized. So what, there is no, We don't have any kind of measure of effort. I was thinking, but this is like really a long shot. I don't know why. So sometimes when these tests are being constructed, I don't know who constructed it. They constructed them such that it should be that everybody has time to try all the questions and solve all the questions. I don't know if it was constructed like that, but in case it was, maybe you can just try to sort of like look at who, how much they tried. I mean, if it was constructed, maybe it would give you something. I mean, in principle, one could have think about eliciting beliefs about at least like if they think, I mean, if you want to, if they think that they could be at the top, we can talk about how you can do that. And again, it could be that just to begin with, everybody was highly motivated, and then in a group like that, it's really hard to provide them incentives to do better. And I think that the fact that they are young will have an impact here, and you do seem to find that younger students are less responsive to all of these incentives. So it could be that this is something to do with basically the teachers standing there and saying, well, you should try now, please do your best, and that carries a lot of weight with them. One thing that I would have imagined is that I would have imagined that the better behaved students, so the girls, would also be the ones that would put the highest effort to begin with. So they, but if this is how we think about it, so they should have the smallest impact of incentives, and we actually see exactly the opposite. So those who behave better by all the measures that we have are actually having the largest impact of incentives. So the first thing that I thought about, then I said, oh, Tim, can you tell me what's going on there? So maybe the boys are just not affected because they are the worst one, which they are. So at first I thought, oh, that's great. They are really.
You know, they do worse here, they do worse here, they do worse here. They even do worse here, which is another non-incentivized test, IQ test. I looked at them and so was like, what? But so they do worse until it comes to the 2015 math test course. The boys are doing worse, until it comes to the 2015 math test course, and then all of a sudden, even though the girls are better grade and blah, 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 whatever, they have higher IQ, whatever you want, then all of a sudden they're doing the same. So that made me think that maybe the boys, I was thinking about it possibly before, that maybe the boys are actually playing a different game than the girls, and they're actually competing with each other. I was wondering, this is a math test. I think it fits well with some stuff on there, that's why. So this is a math test, maybe like that's what implicitly they're basically playing this game in which they're competing. They want to see who have the best scores because this is a math test and it just doesn't go on any other test. It's possible that maybe these measures of good behavior, so this could be one thing. The other thing I'm thinking maybe is these measures of good behavior, which are made by the teachers. So basically that the girls internalize this external pressure to do well. But if they only respond to, you know, so if they only respond to these external measures, when you take them away, like the 2015 test, this would be another possibility, right? So if you take them away, they are just not putting any effort. I mean, that would also explain why they're actually responding. I mean, I don't know. So to begin with, did you have, is there a gap, gender gap on the test or in the control group?
That's a good question. I haven't looked at that, only the 2015 version.
No, the 2016, no.
Yeah.
The control, yeah. Only on the 15,
yeah,
not on the,
I haven't,
so,
looked at that one. Yeah,
so,
that's a really,
so maybe it would tell you if it could, you know, maybe it could tell you what,
that's a good
there
idea.
Is something there. Okay, so this was sort of like something that I could think about when it comes to the non-cognitive outcomes, which I even find a little bit weirder. So the incentive had a non-negligible, it's really non-negligible impact on self-reported personality traits, in particular on openness, conscientiousness, and extroversion. But only with the honors incentives, and the impact is both for girls and for boys. So this is not now, there is no, doesn't seem to be gender differences, and we know that there was randomization at the student level, so we cannot come up with all sorts of other stories, like, you know, you did not control for something correctly, and that's where it's coming from. So my guess would be that, so this would be my first guess, that those who think that they're unlikely to win the reward, they would like to make sure to you, to the teachers, to the world, that they were actually, that they actually are, you know, that they didn't get it, but they are still like trying to get it. So this would be, again, more important with the owner's reports, which are the socially desirable one. But with the money, you can always think that they thought, so I didn't get the money, but that's because I'm not greedy, maybe. So I could see why they're stating that they're smart and not lazy. So I could see the openness and the conscientiousness. But also because I get something from the girls that seems like that in some other place. But why they are stating that they are more extrovert, I don't know.
So I have some Chinese friends, and she claims that extroversion is not desirable in China. So if you ask these type of things, people should actually, the desirable trait is to say that you are an introvert, that you are, even if you are not. So she was, you know, so maybe this is just an explanation why they didn't turn down them, though, because they are not, because they're extroverts, that they're smart, they're not lazy, but they're extroverts. I
also had a similar impression, and when I had this question of like how, you know, there for some of the big five, there's not always an obvious direction for which one's better or not, and what kind of, these are, I didn't show you, Cindy, the correlation, so you wouldn't have had this, but it turned out that the extroversion, the teacher rating of extroversion was positively correlated with these other measures of class performance and also their grades. And so somehow, somehow in this case, the extroversion was positively correlated with other kind of good things.
So it could be, so her statement was that what you should say is that you are shy, and you should say that you are introvert even if you are not. So that's, so even if you are not, so people, so this is, again, maybe she's talking about adults, maybe she's much older than them, so maybe it's a different generation. But sort of like this is what she, I don't know. But if it's positive, then it would go with the same one. Why it has an impact on how the girls assessed others, I mean, again, maybe it's some kind of, so I would always think that this is just as an, to explain why they win, they didn't win, some sort of like, you know, the others were so good, so of course I couldn't win, or something like that, but if it's coming from those who didn't win, then, or won, I mean, you can just, you know, we would have liked to have the beliefs, not there, but I mean, if there is something in it, it must be, you know, so under the assumption that they ex ante thought about what was going to have the next post, you can just look at it and see if it's coming from one or not. Okay, so let me just say that it seems like, you know, that people tend to respond to the incentives that we provide them, and this response is like, seems to me that it could be extremely complicated with some interaction between the exact situation, the culture, and the implicit and explicit incentive that we are providing them. I think that, you know, it seems fairly clear that these measures of non-cognitive skills are being affected by the situation, the incentives, and whatever else was going on there. And I think that we do have a fairly clear theories about what to expect when it comes to monetary incentives. So, you know, people will be more shocked than not if you say, well, monetary incentives did not increase performance. But when it comes to any kind of effect of any type of incentives on non-cognitive measures, I mean, then I think we know very little, and I think this is a good thing that we should try to figure out more.
Thank you so much.
So we have like 2 minutes.
Great.
Sorry.
I guess I didn't really have too many responses except that it's so, I make these long presentations with long appendices, and it's so nice to see that some of the slides actually got discussed that I hadn't gotten a chance to, so thank you.
Hi, Angela Duckworth and Marty Seligman published a paper in 2006 where they said that girls do better on grades in class, but boys do better on the standardized exams. So that would kind of fit your thing. So the girls are doing better on the grades in class, but then the boys come up to their level for the standardized test. And
it doesn't fit with the IQ test scores. So the IQ test scores, I thought about this, but the IQ test scores looked again the opposite way. So the IQ, there's still the IQ was, right, in 2015, it was non-incentivized. And on the IQ, on the Raven test, it was again doing better.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other thing is that since there's such a strong cultural bias not to brag and not to praise yourself and not to build yourself up, maybe there's a slightly different cultural connotation to these things for girls than boys. So it may not seem like you're praising yourself on these so much if you're a girl, because it's more important that the boys be good on these. So the boys might feel more constrained about praising themselves on it, because it would feel like higher praise for a boy. I don't know, but that's a possibility.
That's an interesting thought, because maybe the girls feel more comfortable with praising themselves if they also praise their peers in a similar way.
Right.
Yeah.
I think some papers maybe by Catherine Voss and
there
were some papers by Catherine Voss, the VOHS, and by Meister, I think, on the money frame and how framing the same question in terms of money affects, you know, your performance, but also your selfishness, this kind of thing.
Mm.
And I really think they're going the right direction. The kind of not going to measure changes you have could have to do with this frame of mind, but just the money frame.
Mm.
And in a sense, I mean, what Mulanikin does with framing a question in terms of money and what it does to stress, in a sense, goes with this idea that money really changes the way you look at questions and for how you may answer the defined questions.
Thank you.
I just want to point out, so Dan Benjamin has some work on priming / framing, which you may have seen. And the idea there is simply that if you prime someone and say it's about being religious, then if they're religious, like, oh, religious people behave in this way, then suddenly it changes my utility function such that I want to be consistent with this ideal of being religious. But it's a transitory thing. So one question I had is, first, to what extent are they just, is this a bias? And to what extent is it just an actual transitory change in their behaviors? The second question is, and we should get to the gender differences, it seems plausible to me that being an honorable man is different from being an honorable woman, or like what that means in Chinese society, such that you may get different behaviors, for example, those reasons, because they're adopting different sort of methods or models that they're trying to sort of be consistent with.
No, thank you. I don't know that Benjamin works, so that's great. And I guess I don't have a good response to your question about the transitory nature. We haven't done a follow-up, so what this tells me is that these kinds of surveys could be very sensitive to small things, but I think it's a huge question. I mean, if they're sensitive to small things for a very short period of time, that's very different than if, 2 weeks later you gave the same survey. And I might look into whether we can do some kind of follow-up like that, because the key takeaway then would be, you want to give your follow-up survey a little bit after you've done the evaluation.
There's a lot of work called stereotype threat on that, or
yeah.
It's just even just asking somebody their gender before doing that, you would get changes in their behavior.
Isn't that one of those that no one's able to replicate?
Well, that's a transit. No, they replicated stereotype threat a lot. And specifically as it relates to gender roles and how you then participate in those team stuff. But I think it's again transitory. But that might be another thing you can say, is this behaving the same way? You can look at how they've analyzed their tech threat in their stuff and see if any of their models apply to that.
To the extent that you could come up with a behavioral task for conscientiousness or one of the big fives that you administer alongside, that could be really interesting to see if this real transitory effect versus just purely a measurement bias, right? And then do a follow-up.
Yeah, no, that would be great if we can.
You could also, in the stereotype threat thing, you could also do, depending on how big your sample is, can't remember, but in blocks where you would ask half of the kids in advance of the test and half of the kids post-test some of these questions to see if either their test scores or their
yeah.
You could also ask which of those incentives they want. Do they want to take the honor?
Or
they
prefer,
they want the money?
Which one they prefer, yeah. Yeah, we could give them the option, actually. We could say you would either give. You get to pick which one you want.
It could be assigned or choice, or it could be, yeah, they get the opposite of what they want.
Yes.
Tim, did you do a structural equation model of the big BFI 44? Because sometimes in Chinese cultures, it's messy. Did you do that? Try to see whether you could actually recapture those factors? I saw you did all sorts of cool, item level analysis, but that would, for me, be a really important thing to know.
You're saying, do they have the same kind of correlation structure?
The actual, the factor structure should And I'm very dubious of another BFI 44. Was it the two or was it the one? Was it the new one or the old one?
I'm sorry. Oh, this is the new BFI 44, but not the BFI 60.
Yeah. I want to see. This is just psychologists talking there, right? I would want to see that factor structure was recoverable in that pool of data.
Yeah, I think it would be really interesting. I think to me, though, I doubt it. Looking at the item level analysis, I don't think it would change the impact that we were finding, because we were finding it pretty consistently across all five. So if you recombine them, it would also show a similar pattern. But I do think it would be interesting to see if the structure does compare, just to know.
Brent Roberts just published this meta-analysis on effect sizes for personality interventions. Mm. Have you seen that?
No.
So he gets an estimate of around, I think, 0.4, effect size 0.4, 0.5, that persists. But these are like clinical interventions. So they give a big five pre-post random assignment. And so that's about two or three times bigger than your effect size. So maybe one of the criticisms of that work, of course, is exactly what you're talking about. You don't know whether the trait change or whether people are responding differently for whatever reason. I mean, it's exactly the same issue. But your study maybe suggests that there's probably at least a little bit of it that is kind of unexplainable intervention effects, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think that's what I was thinking about. And I think even the SEL ones I showed earlier had effect sizes that were bigger than what we were finding. So
yeah,
if I mean, this is only one mechanism through which responses could be affected. But if you thought this was what was going on in those, it wouldn't explain everything.